So I'll give a overview first and then launch in. I'll speak a little bit about the condo or the aggregates generally so that we have a sense of context. And then I'll move into guided individual silent practice, meaning that we'll all just sit here as we are now. I recommend at that point closing your eyes, and I'll guide a meditation, and that this will last a while. And the meditation will be focused on the first of the khanda, Rupa form. Then there'll be a little shift as we move into pairs. I believe Lucy's the host, so she'll take care of dividing us into pairs. And then we'll be in insight dialogue after I offer the contemplation and we move into our separate rooms. That will be about 20 minutes. Then we'll be brought back, and then we can explore together our experience, our inquiry of Rupa. Okay? So let's begin by thinking about what the nature of this teaching is, these aggregates. And the perspective I'd like to begin with is very kind of simple science. When we look at the human situation, you might say, in some very basic physical way, what we actually have is the flux of astonishingly sensitive sense organs and a unfathomably complex, interconnected brain. And the body-mind processing all of these inputs. And in fact, even the basis, the physical basis of that, is at its most basic level, atomic, subatomic, and so on, flux also, right? So whether it's one person or 1,000 people, 2 people in a dyad, the picture looks the same at every level. There's nothing but flux. Flux in the, you might say, objective sense, and flux in the experiencing that happens, that we call seeing, hearing, tasting, touching, smelling, thinking, and so on. There are no objects. There are no features of objects. There's nothing we could call even anything more than the functioning of the organism. We don't even have something like seeing. There's just the functioning of the eye and so on. Out of this chaos, out of this void of simply flux, the organism naturally begins to try to make sense of it, parsing all of these complex streams through all these gateways and forming impressions born of the natural pattern matching that goes on with the brain mind. At the same time, of course, there are the reactions that have been built into the biological mechanism of recoiling from what's unpleasant and threatening and unsafe, of moving towards what will sustain life or bring pleasure. And there's also a, let's call it a not so much a throwing out as a ignoring or not processing, not even registering most of what's coming in. Most of what's coming in, we don't even know it's coming in. So out of the totality of this flux, there's little pieces that appear to make up what we call reality. And this is happening in this very moment that I'm speaking. It's happening every moment of everyone's life. That's just how it is, very basic. So we know that the kind of complexity that's reduced to a lesser complexity that we call this is how life is, that kind of complexity, produces all kinds of attachments and illusions. You know, we can talk about that as we go forward. But what happens is the entanglements of wanting and not wanting and physical pain and emotional pain and the formation from our environment of individual differences and relational complexities and all of the things that we look at as this life, the features of this life and the suffering of this life come up out of this minute fraction of what we actually take in and how we interact with each other and so on. And the patterns of suffering are common across all human beings. And also, each of us has our own special brand, our suffering secret sauce that's just ours. But it all is arising and vanishing in this stew of ongoing formation and dissolving. So we know that the Buddha's teachings are, in a nutshell, about suffering and the end of suffering. That's the whole thing, right? That's the point of it. And the understanding this basic structure, the structure of the human being in the ways I've just described it, is foundational to understanding his teachings on suffering and the end of suffering. And throughout the discourses, one of the, if not the most common, regularly found, clearly enunciated teachings is on the khanda, the aggregates, which are these five ways of describing this flux. So it's reasonable for us to ask, why, out of this unnameable complexity, what are these five things? Why name them? What's the purpose of this aggregate of descriptions or of pointers? Why was it taught so consistently, so often? Why was it so central to the Buddhist dispensation? First of all, let's remember that the Buddha was under no illusion that this was true. He was very aware that all of his teachings, the whole of the Dhamma, was constructed. He explicitly said so. So we're dealing with a particular construct, these five khandha. And since the entire teaching is oriented towards suffering and the end of suffering, it was specifically taught with a purpose, understanding suffering and the end of suffering. And so somehow it's up to us to realize that purpose. To put it on the negative side, this is not a philosophy. This is not a statement about what's real. It is a practice. It's a way of understanding one's own life, and that understanding comes about through reflection, through practice, observation, investigation. As we approach the khandhas, then, our approach is as practice, always as practice. It's always to apply it to this very life. And as with other meditation practices that we do, in order to apply it, we take special practice time, like in silence or in insight dialogue, to explore and get clear what is this aspect of the human experience of, let's say, form, rupa. What is this aspect of the human experience of pleasant and unpleasant and neutral feelings? What is it? How can I kind of locate the center of that? What is this thing, perception, sanya? What is this construction, or what are these constructions, or what is this constructing process? And finally, what is consciousness, vijnana? And it's in the workshop, if you will, of individual silent meditation, of insight dialogue, that we cultivate meditative qualities and explore these aggregates and their qualities and their function. And then in our lives, because we've taken that time, we've done that homework, this begins to become clear and available to us as just a practice, a reflection, a reference point when we're back in the everyday flood of experiences, responsibilities, and so on. So it's with that intention that we explore the khandha. So with that in mind, I'd like to invite us into some silent practice, which I will guide. And for starters, I'd like to check that your physical posture is stable, that you're entering this as meditation as such, which is to say that the body is comfortably erect. You might check your balance from left to right. Find the midline, the center, forward and back, so that your body is aligned, the spine straight. Over the tailbone, the weight resting on the hips. The head and the neck are centered and straight. You might see if they are. However your legs are, I hope that they're comfortable, that your feet are, if you're sitting in a chair, I hope they're flat on the ground. If you're sitting cross-legged, just that they're comfortable. So you could check the entire body. The entire body is upright, comfortable, alert. Sensing the body. Sensing the body. So the body relaxes into the sitting position, but also is alert, alive, awake. A sitting form. Resting down into the body. The mindfulness easily established. The body sense is accessible. Natural. Just a body sitting. Not trying to do anything, not trying to fall into a particular practice that might be your regular practice, but to really let it be simple. The body is sitting. There's awareness of the body, the whole body sitting. The sense of the whole sitting form is just naturally known. If you happen to notice habitual actions of the mind, don't worry about it.
So as you're just aware of the body sitting,
you might explore the actual sense of this form in this posture, this shape. Does the shape have edges? is the bodily form. Known by the pressure. The sitting on the chair or the cushion. Is the bodily form known by temperature, whether on the skin or within the edges of the form? Is the bodily form known by the movement of the air through the breathing or the gases that are carried by the blood? This form as it is right now. Or perhaps the bodily form is known by the liquids in the mouth, or any sensing of the liquids throughout the body. Just as there are liquids externally, there are liquids internally. Water is just water. The solids of the body, the earth of the body, no different than the solids, the chemicals of the stones and the trees externally. Just this physical form. Just these elements, elements sitting here. elements sitting here in this shape, this sitting form. You might look more carefully, more discernment. How do I know the body is sitting here? How do I know there is something solid here? What does experience, without assumptions, actually tell me? Is there a stable thing, an entity here? See for yourself. Simply what presents to awareness. What is known of this form? See for yourself if there's anything stable, permanent. And if you find something, maybe just let the mind, let the attention rest there. And if not, what is the experience? You might give your attention specifically to the arising of form, the experience of this bodily form. Rising, pouring into the moment. At the moment of the arising, there is no past or future, there's just the arising. You can examine this for yourself right now. Present moment of knowing form, constantly emergent. No past, no future. Just the arising. You might notice a shift of perspective and inquire into the vanishing of form. Each moment, it seems like the present moment, vanishing. Present, apparently, becoming past instantly, every instant. Nothing enduring, nothing to hold on to. The deep impermanence of this form, the vanishing in each moment. Just see what can be known here and now. See for yourself. Is there anything to hold on to here? This form, this rupa. Can you freeze it, this form? Can you control it? The chemical processes of aging, can you control them? The molecules, the temperatures, the liquids and solids. Do you own them? Is this mine? This form, this solidity and liquidity, do you own it? This body sitting, simply being known, the form of the body. Rupa. in the moment, I'll be inviting you into groups of two. And we'll be extending this contemplation into our dyads. And in particular, I'd like to point to some of the teachings that the Buddha offered for observing and reflecting on the khandhas, in this case, Rupa. So looking internally, or when you pause, and giving yourself enough time to notice, is there something solid here? And perhaps you can describe the experience where it feels solid and where it doesn't. The Buddha likened this rupa to a lump of foam. Nothing actually substantial there. See for yourself. Don't take his word or anyone's word for it. See for yourself. Check out, is this like a lump of foam or is this like a solid rock filled with these mushy liquids? What do you see for yourself? And we're offered the opportunity, especially in this practice, insight dialogue, to explore form internally and externally with another human, not just with trees and so on, which is invited, right? The earth element internally, the earth element externally, solids internally and externally, same thing. Same as walls, material that doors and floors are made out of, and other bodies. Internal and external. Rupa. Lump of foam internally, lump of foam externally. Gross or subtle? Rupa, gross or subtle? And one last thing, permanent or impermanent? This lump of foam or not lump of foam, internal, external, gross, subtle form, permanent, impermanent. See for yourself with your meditation partner, and we'll come back in 20 minutes. I'd like to actually open up the space among us now and maybe perhaps explore what you've discovered, or perhaps we can uncover some worthwhile questions. It's a rich teaching. And when it comes to the aggregates as a whole and the purpose and function and how we use it as a teaching, I'll be unfolding that over the, all five sessions. it's if we were to try and cover it all, it would be nothing but a talking head the whole time. So I much prefer getting closer to experience. So the floor is open.
I'll dive in briefly. Lump of clay, piece of foam. Felt like my own experience was definitely around the lump of clay, a sense of solidity, some sense of boundaries. Strong awareness of the role of awareness plays in experience of Rupa, where you focus. And then my partner, who may choose to speak or not, also was exploring skeleton and enfleshment, the two experiences that actually brought us a lot of joy. So I'm aware in my own personal experience that structural form and boundaries feel most real. And it's the interaction of conceptual frameworks that loosens that more than direct experience, because those, you know, atoms moving is subtle. Thank you.
Hi, it's Nancy. And just briefly, I experienced a lot of clinging to the constructs. And through my dialogue with my partner, I identified fear as a large factor. And I came to an insight that my usual sense of practice is that practice is love. And I really came to see that practice is brave. So go forth.
I was very aware of the moment, the instant of naming form in terms of lump of foam or a wave of a sensation or an edge that begins to feel more solid and the rest kind of disappears. But I noticed whatever there was more tension, that was easier to notice, yet the mind, the focusing and speaking of it, it felt like unnatural. I'm freezing something that is already gone. To start video. Oh, I'm sorry. Okay, there. So it took a while to be more in sync with how the mind interprets what's arising and vanishing. And then at moments of not just observing the flow, of body tension, contact, edges, seeing, folds, sounds. Then there were moments of just watching what arises and vanishing, and that a sense of more expansiveness and tranquility, and how I need both, we need both, the conceptual mind that gives meaning to the experience of what is body, what is Rupa, and the letting go of it and being closer to how quickly it arises and vanishes and it changes, which is, it's very enlivening, it's impermanence. It's, there really is nothing to hold on to. And that always makes me happy. Thank you.
Something in what you just named that is really valuable for practice, for all of us, is, you know, you said that basically the conceptual helps guide the direct experience and kind of loosen it up. It was a very helpful description. And I'll just add to it that you described, if I recall, that, you know, when you went from the conceptual to the immediate, let's call it, that there was a kind of a, or at least I heard you as referring to something closer and, as you said, impermanent, more fluid. So let's go in reverse with that for a minute, from the immediate and fluid to the conceptual. And for that to happen, for the arising of concept like that, that is a way of seeing the clinging, the upadana, that is referred to with these aggregates. These are the clinging aggregates. I'll talk more about that probably next week. But in this case, the clinging necessary for the conceptualization, and the conceptualization is nothing other than the Buddha's teachings. I mean, this is Buddha Dhamma you're talking about, right? So let's not get into like that's bad or something like that. It guides your practice, right? And then you let go of it, and then you come to the immediacy. So I just want to reflect back what you said and give it that one little more piece of information about clinging and then the coming into the immediacy that is non-clinging, because in the flux of experience, there's, you know, nothing to be found. There's only the flux. So any crystallizing of distance out of the flow of what's just experience. There's no existence, there's just experience. And that freezing, in this case, is being used intentionally to guide the mind, and then it's let go of again. And then, of course, there's the ways that the crystallizing of experience and the clinging to it leads us down the road of pain. So, yeah, thank you for that description, Delia. You know, I'm just reflecting because I keep putting myself in my own position and in your position in everyday life. And I'm saying these things that sound super refined, and indeed they are. But they're also, I really want to stress this throughout our exploration of the khandhas, These are practices for refined meditation and for life. So in daily life, when things are busy and the mind is more gross, naturally what you won't be able to catch the subtle clinging, but you can still catch the gross clinging. And the gross clinging works exactly the same way. You hold on, it becomes real, and it proliferates into, you know, a life that in one moment might be pleasant and another moment might be unpleasant, but in the holding to it, you have the essential dukkha, the essential unsatisfactoriness of holding, and the organism is once again trying to control, trying to get balance. It's not free. There's not the knowledge and vision of release, as they say, in that moment, right? So I really want to stress that everyday accessibility of the practice, if you know it's there for you. If you don't know it's there, then, you know, you might not take advantage of it.
So in that context, you know, I had this experience of kind of the opposite of the fluidity, that there was a real jerkiness. Being in the space where it, you know, of the flow, and just like the image came of like the watercolors just bleeding. You were asking about the boundaries, and just being there with the experience. And then the mind comes in with something. It was, you know, I don't recall, but something that is based on I. And I watched the body actually jerk to like kind of to occupy that. Oh, I need to go back and occupy this I. And how, you know, it was so interesting for me to see, like, it was like there were two separate, anyway, very unfluid fields. I could occupy here, occupy there. I'm over here. The mind moves into concepts, and it's like, okay, body, come back. You know, yeah. Somebody. So.
Yeah. Yeah, perhaps some of you have seen that or experienced that on silent retreat, where it can be really, you know, kind of a sense of almost shocking to go from the subtlety of experience into finding yourself in the rigidity of your own fabrications.
Actually, I still have the experience of the body as a field of density, and all the rest is density too. A different density. And what is interesting to me is there's a decenteredness from that. And the thoughts or the concepts just explained, they are helpful, and yet they are options. It's like there's no need to grab on them. They do not diminish the sense of space. And that's quite interesting. So there isn't possibility of having the concepts and a sense of fluidity at the same time. It's not like an either or.
There's an interesting passage in the discourses that I think sheds some light on what you were just saying, Birgit. The so talking about one who has sort of let's just say awakened and such a person, when they feel a pleasant feeling, they feel it detached. When they feel an unpleasant feeling, they feel it detached. When they feel a neutral feeling, they feel it detached. And from that, one can get a sense of that not only are these feelings still happening, but they also can register as pleasant and unpleasant and neutral. But there's, if I can inject your word fluidity there, there's this fluidity of experience where even as these different things are happening that are, you know, just as raw for a, you know, in terms, in material terms or in physical terms, for a an awakened person as they are for an unawakened person, that the without the clinging and identification, they're just, you know, moving through. I don't know if that, you know, is an exactly connected to what you're saying, but I think it might be worth reflecting on. I'm noticing that the time for our closing is here. And so next week, we'll continue, we'll explore Vedana, the next aggregate or khanda. And between now and then, I hope your practice is good. I hope that there's something here to reflect on for you. That would be really warm my heart if this actually entered your life in a useful, wholesome way. And meanwhile, we can close by remembering with gratitude our opportunity to have access to good teachings and to have this community of investigation, a very special thing. And that knowing that our joining together is in service of the release, the understanding, the awakening of ourselves, of everyone here, and indeed in service of all other beings who are suffering, confused, and to be recollecting our place in this whole. May all beings, near and far, of every type of consciousness, be free from suffering, the causes of suffering. May all beings, high and low, large and small, the seen and the unseen, may they be free from suffering. Beings without exception. Accept the loving kindness also of every being and creature in return, and share the benefits of this meditation with everyone. May all beings be well and happy. May there be peace. May there be peace. May there be peace.